here today with Imre Kondor, Alan Kirman, and Stefano Battiston. And they are grantees here for a very challenging and interesting project called Correlations in Complex Heterogeneous Networks, the Problem of Identifying SIFIs, the Systemically Important Financial Institutions. Welcome. Now, let me see if I have this a little bit straight. I'll talk to you first, Imre. You put this whole thing sort of together. The important thing here is that you are insisting that we understand the economic system as a complex system, which means that you cannot understand it in a local area, that the effect of any individual institution, you have to understand the system as a whole. Is that correct?
Yes. My impression is that one of the fundamental features of complex systems is that somehow they spontaneously generate long-range correlations, so that if you cut the system into two, you do not end up with two similar systems, but something which may be completely different. But the intriguing thing is that that these long-range correlations emerge even or emerge typically in the presence of collaboration and competition, so attractive and repelling interactions.
Now, when you say long-range correlations, what you mean is correlations between entities that are far apart?
Yes,
is that what you
for
mean?
Example, far apart or which are seemingly not directly connected.
Because they're connected indirectly through other...
Well, all kinds of indirect influences
spreading
along the network.
But just to pursue this for one moment, but the important thing in terms of the project of identifying systemically important financial institutions is that you can't just look at who they're connected to immediately.
That's you cannot decide it locally.
Yes.
You cannot attach this property of being important systemically to a given institution. This is what makes regulation extremely tricky.
And you mention in the proposal the interbank money market as an example of such a system, this market which I know something about, which really froze up in this financial crisis, and it froze up because of the problem of a really small set of assets, as a matter of fact, and it was very surprising. I remember economists at the time saying, "Oh well, subprime mortgages, there's not very many of those. That's not really going to be a problem," but it was a problem.
It was a problem, yes. And this is just one of the mechanisms that generates these correlations. But exposure in the same market or indirect links, even going as far as this general ethos of the trade, you know, which is permeating all the business schools, all the trading desks, everything. And these people tend to look at the same Bloomberg terminal. So that there are all kinds of indirect influences which are somehow generating a very large degree of coherence.
So you're, as far as I understand the way this project works, you're first exploring the properties of some simple kinds of systems, and then you're building up to try to capture as close as you can the topology, I think you use that word, of the actual financial network, the shadow banking system and so forth.
Yeah, you see, the fundamental problem of heterogeneous agent models is that you have to deal with an extremely complicated system which is characterized by a very large number of parameters. So it's a very high dimensional problem. And therefore, I thought that the logical thing would be to try to separate the different features, try to separate topology and then the symmetry of the interaction. And as we move on, we are trying to approach the complex networks which Stefano is trying to unravel.
So you come to this project, you're interested in these social network, economic networks. That's your background. And so you bring to this what? You've been collaborating with Imre for a while?
Yes. So we have been together in other projects in the past. And I think that what my specific part that I'm bringing into this project has to do with models of networks which where units have some specificities, some characteristics which are plausible from the point of view of finance. We've got them probably building on existing models, and we have a number of them where we have interlocking balance sheets. So there are two sources of correlation, or three, let's say. The first one is exposure to common or similar shocks because of the portfolios of assets that are external to the banking network, to the interbank market. There are correlations due to the interlocking balance sheets, and there are correlations due to similar strategies in general. Imre was mentioning the fact that everybody's probably using similar models and looking at similar data, and therefore this creates homogeneous views, which, by the way, is one of the issues that has been raised by Haldane on the...
Andy Haldane,
right. The edge knife property of financial systems arising from, at the same time, complexity mm-hmm. and opacity, but at the same time, homogeneity, and mm-hmm. these correlations are part of that homogeneity.
So now both you, Imre, and you, Stefano, you come from physics, okay? But your third member of your team here is Alan Kirman, and he comes from economics, from general equilibrium. So tell me how that fits into this project.
Okay, so in the first place, general equilibrium theory had this view that people were in some sense isolated, right? They're all acting independently of each other, essentially. But, you know, you hear all the time in economics expressions like panic, contagion, and mistrust. And those are not words that fit in at all into the general equilibrium model. I mean, those words have no significance. Mm-hmm. But they do have significance when people have relationships with each other, when they're trading with each other, and so forth. And so networks and that sort of structure seem to be a natural way to do it. Mm-hmm. But more generally, I mean, let's just say one thing. In economics, everybody's taught micro, and everybody's taught macro. But nobody's taught what happens in between. And what we're talking about here is interaction between the agents, which is what separates micro from macro. So, you know, that's where we should really be interested. That's where all the action is, in some sense. And that's something which we've somehow left to one side.
Now, one of the interesting things about your project, if I understand the proposal right, is that you're really taking some tools and analytical strategies from statistical physics and applying them to economics. But the second thing I'm noticing is you're very much engaged with the policymakers. You know, getting some measure that could be helpful to the regulators. This combination of sort of fundamental research but very practical goals is quite unusual, actually.
Well, let me tell you that there was this period when I was working in a bank in Hungary as head of risk management. And that happened to be the period when Hungary took over the international regulation, Basel I. I happened to be the chairman of the Hungarian Association of Risk Managers. And as such, I had to negotiate with the finance ministry, the central bank, the banking supervision, about the precise interpretation of the translation which they made of the European rule. So that I got the impression that the whole set of regulations was inconsistent to a very large degree, and I took an interest in the logical and mathematical structure of this mm-hmm. of this regulation.
Well, this is very interesting. This measure that you have in mind is meant to augment what the policymakers are currently doing, and you say the policymakers are currently focusing on size, substitutability, and connectedness. And all three of these are sort of local measures.
Well, this is the logic of the law.
Yes.
You cannot formulate a regulation which depends on the collective state of a large ensemble. This is the internal paradox of regulation.
I see, because you can't make an entity legally liable or for the behavior
of the system. Yes.
But what you could do with this fourth criteria, and I want to hear a little bit about that, is the regulators could watch it. You know, they could monitor it. Is that the idea?
Yes, they can, and I think it's extremely important that they realize that there is something lurking in the background which cannot be locally identified, mm-hmm. which depends on the whole state of the whole system. And let me just give you a very simple example which probably will illustrate this point, that we had some initial preliminary runs of systems which are having 10,000 nodes. And it turns out that if you happen to hit one element of the strongly correlated cluster, then the whole system reacts very violently. You can reorganize 10,000 nodes just by fixing or forcefully flipping over one of the nodes. Whereas if you hit one, which happens to be very weakly correlated with the rest, then nothing's going to happen.
The sort of things we've been talking about, if you talk to central bankers, if you talk to people who actually make policy about these, they're very receptive to it. But it's the interesting thing is that the economics profession, particularly macroeconomists, are very reluctant to discuss this sort of thing.
Actually, this project is also building on previous and ongoing efforts in other projects, in particular European projects, where we are directly in contact and in collaboration with the European Central Bank and also with other national central banks. And as Alan was saying, it's very remarkable how those people are very receptive to this type of methods, where maybe there is a little bit less theory, but you learn.
But it also sounds like what you're saying is that the central bankers find your methodological approach connects with their intuition about how the system works. And so that's why they're able to talk to you, because they feel like, yes, that's what it is. It's a complex network.
Macroprudential regulation.
And then the other thing you can think about is, even if you say, well, what sort of measures could you take? People have come to a conclusion now that you have to take specific measures when this thing does collapse, or when the interbank market collapse, what happened? The European Central Bank essentially has taken the place of that network. That network
yes.
no longer
it's
essentially
taken the money market onto
right.
its own balance
yes.
sheet.
And yes. so, and of course, that creates all sorts of other hazards, and
it's
which
a new
we should
system.
Think about. Well, we should think about the fact that now all the banks borrow from the European Central Bank at a very low rate of interest, and then invest in government bonds at a higher rate of interest, and they're not replacing the network.
I see. Yes, well, this is definitely new economic thinking. So I can see why our referee suggested to support this grant, and I'm glad we are. And I'm looking forward to hearing the results of your research as the time goes by. But meanwhile, definitely welcome to our stable of INET economists.
Thank you.
Thank you.